How was your day? Had a good day too. But I'm feeling a bit restless. You know that feeling when you just need someone to say something. Doesn't really have to be anything particular. It can just be a story, or they can just talk and ramble all they want to. So, yeah. So, I figured I'd read you a story today. That you could lay down in bed next to me and relax, chill out. I'll read for you until you fall asleep, or when the story stops. Either one of those things. I missed you so much today. You do look a bit tired. It's okay. It's sleepy time. Time to wind down and relax with a story and your mind just do its own thing. Let go of all the thoughts that may or may not bother you. It can be hard to do so when you've had a whole day of thinking about all kinds of different things. But I know that you're getting better, right? That's good. Next to me, and I'll read you a story from this book I got from a friend of mine, H.D. Collins. And this is a, I'm like kind of reading all the stories. It's called The Guy in 13 and Other Stories, Other Fictions. Here are 13 stories I wrote between 1988 and 2011. They take place in Amsterdam, Atlantic City, Boston, Buffalo, Los Angeles, Montreux, Niagara Falls, Paris, Bienvenida, Providence, and various suburbias of the heart. Two of them are set in the past, and one a few decades in the future. But most of them happen roughly nowish, depending on your size of now. And I think I'm gonna read you this one. Thinking I wanted to read to you The Headbanger's Daughter's Great-Grandfather, the Nazi. So, I hope for listening to the story. Thank you. great-grandfather the Nazi. Since last Monday, Tasha has turned 18, fallen hard in and out of love, escaped a near-fatal bike accident on the clerk's lot with just a bruised elbow, got high with mom to celebrate her divorce, and watched her great-grandfather arm get lowered into the ground. What a week was that, she thinks, sipping apple juice from a straw. Her mother has brought her to a dark place. It is Friday night. The metal music is so hard, it's almost soft. All knives and razors whirling up into a deafening kitty cat fur. The people in here are all old, like over 25. Ma'am needed a dose of this club and wanted Tasha with her. Please don't make me go home, Mom said. So they came straight from the Thai restaurant, still in their funeral gear, and fit right in here with the skulls and black light and cigarette stink. Almost instantly, Mom ran into some old comrades and left her daughter alone at the end of the bar by the toilets. Tasha gazes at the display of an unused gambling machine, expecting nothing. Maybe she'll have to pee soon. The funeral was in a reformed church, so stark it could have been an aircraft hangar. Back on an unseen organ. Known him well, and that, her mother whispered, was for the best. The burial took place in Vodokavsmir, under a lightly spitting grey, with no god at all. That was Tasha's favorite part of the whole sorry day. She ignored everyone and watched the sky, and found a private relief in its featurelessness. Maybe they all thought she was praying. The one time she ever met him, Tasha felt an unexpected bond with Harm. He gazed at the universe with wide, empty, pale blue eyes, just as Tasha does, not to look at anything, but because his eyes were accidentally open. He just sat there. He never disguised his boredom, never listened to whatever his nurses and visitors were saying. He just sat there, as Tasha is doing right now. But being 69, Harm was entitled to do things Tasha may not, like piss himself and be forgiven, or announce to the world that his family are all Bolshevik cunts, while casually planting his hand on Mom's ass and leaving it there. Even then, it was hard to imagine he'd ever done anything wrong in his life. He never meant to become a burden on anyone, he said to Tasha, looking right in her eye. And she realized neither did she. Mom pulled off at the A10 and they were just passing the KFC when Tasha said she wished she could be like him. Old Harm, so empty, so innocent. Said it so softly she figured her mother didn't hear. Mom reached over and tapped her just hard enough to knock Tasha's glasses off into her lap. After a moment, her glasses back on and turned to look at her, just as Mom was writing. After a moment, Tasha put her glasses back on and turned to look at her, just as Mom was waiting to take a left onto the hot vic. Their eyes met for a teeth of a tick, and Mom said nothing. Unlike her mother, Tasha doesn't often wear black. Doesn't listen to this kind of music, doesn't smoke or drink, and certainly doesn't hang out in bars. She'd sooner be home watching Ibiza 24/7 on RTL Lounge than sitting here pretending she doesn't know that woman. Mom's politely concealing jacket and shawl are off now. She's She's crazy, Tasha said then, laying the cork So, and nothing, Omahani said. On paper, he was an NSB-er. After the war, he sat 2 years in the internment camp. They put him to work rebuilding sewers. They put him to work rebuilding sewer lines in Zealand. That's your great grandfather, the Nazi. If you think about it, of course, Omahani never asked to be born into a year of poverty and recrimination, just as Mom never asked to be born into a year of Nixon and plenty, just as Sasha never asked to wake up this morning. These things just happen. She's in denial. Mom would explain later in the car. She doesn't know. Now the door of the club whacks open, and a big man tumbles in as if someone threw him. He spills onto the bar, so close to Tasha that she can smell his leather jacket and the weed on his breath. Bauman. A pint of lager, he shouts out in English, as if shouting will help him here. Tasha marks him, typical Brit, across for the weekend, the kind of things Amsterdam is a whorehouse, or a pissoir, or both. She's seen him in 1,000 incarnations. He plants a big hand on Tasha's shoulder, and leaves. Mom's here, speaking English, smiling, and flowing like molten lead into the space between them, sacrificing herself to save her child. She has her